Yeah, welcome to the summary of the first part of our reinforcement learning course at Paderborn University. My name is Oliver Walchert, and today I would like to summarize our key insights into the reinforcement learning algorithms and problems, especially in the finite state and action spaces. The key ideas which we have applied to the reinforcement learning methods in discrete state and action spaces are summarized here. So basically we can say that in all control and prediction tasks which we have discussed, that estimating and comparing value functions of course were a key problem. For getting estimates of these value functions, we backed up the values along actual or possible straight trajectories, either based on simulated or real experience. And in order to obtain optimal policies in the control task, we have obtained in all cases some generalized policy iteration style mechanism, GPI style mechanism, where we had a circular sequence of evaluation and improvement steps. So evaluating, trying to improve our prediction of the state values, and then the policy improvement step based on this current state value or action value estimates in order to get better policies. So these three steps can be summarized to all reinforcement learning problems, which we have, not only problems, but also algorithms which we have discussed. Then I would like to summarize also the most important dimensions of reinforcement learning, which we have discussed so far. Two very important dimensions are the update depth and width. So depth here in terms of how many sampled state actions transitions are taken into account, with the two extreme cases Monte Carlo updates, where we took into account the entire state action transitions until the termination of the episode, or temporal difference learning, where we just took into account one sampled state action transition. Second very important dimension, the width of the update. So how much of the state action space is updated during one step. Here the extreme scenario would be dynamic programming, where we update the entire state space or state action space into one big sweep. However, as we have also learned, for example, with asynchronous updates, we could only take into account fractions of the state action space in order to focus our updates on most interesting state action transitions. Also, as an extreme case, we have discussed that during the second lecture, that for very small state and action space, it could be feasible to apply exhaustive search, so really to probe all possible state action combinations over the entire problem space, and therefore to find an optimal solution to the given reinforcement learning prediction or control problem. Of course, this is not feasible then for state and action spaces with a multitude of variables, because then the amount of computations we need would explode in an exponential way. And therefore, we have learned that all these other methods here are then able to save us and to provide us a reinforcement learning solution, also if the state and action space is not tiny. However, these two dimensions, width and depth of the update in the reinforcement learning context, are not the only important reinforcement learning dimensions which we have discussed throughout the last seven lectures. Very importantly, first was to discuss the question what problem space I'm working on. So how many states and actions are there? Do I work with a stochastic environment or deterministic environment? And is the problem or the environment stationary? Or is it maybe changing over time? For example, if I'm working with a technical system, is tier and wear, for example, leading to a changing environmental behavior? Then the policy, which we have derived in the control context, could be learned either in an on-policy or off-policy way. Off-policy way, we added in behavior policy B as an add-on to our target policy pi in order to find an optimal, eventually optimal policy, target policy then, because the target policy didn't need to explore for its own. And the question also, did we really have an explicit policy or maybe only an implicit policy when we use the state values, and then we require to have a one-step look ahead in order to find best optimal choices. The task, of course, could be episodic or continuing depending on the application. the return definition, of course, is of prime importance in order to obtain useful learning sequences. There could be discounting involved, either naturally given by the environment, for example, in financial problems, or it could be part of the choice of the engineer, which is working with the problem here. And of course, the return or slash reward definition can be, of course, either naturally given by the problem, for example, in games, or also finance again, or we as engineers are able to formulate the reward function by ourselves in order to support the learning process. And this is, of course, a very, very important degree of freedom then, because in this case, normally there is not a predefined way in order to define optimal rewards, especially if we are talking about technical problems like technical control. Yeah, the value, of course, is also of prime importance. We have discussed how to estimate and optimize state values and action values, and especially also in the last lecture where we wanted to integrate learning and planning, the model was again highly discussed. Is the model really required in reinforcement learning? No, it is not required. We could use model-free approaches. However, as we have learned, that might be not optimal because we are not using the given data in an efficient way. So integrating learning and planning can be very interesting. If we do so, do we need a distribution model which gives us a full stochastic picture of the environment by some random distributions, or is a sample model enough where we just get sample realizations of certain trajectories? And if we want to work with a model, then of course we can either learn that along the way based on experience with the environment, with the interaction with the environment, or we could also plug in a priori expert knowledge, which is then hopefully improving our reinforcement learning performance either in the control or prediction task. Exploration here also in this sense, of course, is also very important to reinforcement learning. How do we get new policies? How do we get the best possible actions, especially if we start from scratch? Here we have learned, let's say, only the very basics so far. For example, look at epsilon greedy strategies. There we just took random actions independently from the situation in the problem space. So this is, let's say, really the baseline way in order how to explore. Of course, for small finite set and action spaces, we have found guarantees that that type of exploration under some technical conditions will then eventually lead to the optimal policy. However, is that realistic using just random exploration solutions? And this has to be also discussed in a subsequent lecture. How can we improve the exploration strategy? How can we make the exploration more intelligent and therefore to increase again the learning speed and also increase the likelihood, of course, to find a suitable strategy? Because as we will see also in the next couple of lectures, that if we are operating on non-finite state and action spaces, that policies can also diverge to complete nonsense, and here is exploration also of prime importance. If we then want to update our policy or especially our value functions, we can do that in different ways. We can do synchronously or asynchronously, and especially if we do it asynchronously, how do we do it? In which order do we do it? How do we focus maybe on some updates which are more important for our problem? So if you maybe remember the priority sweeping from the previous lecture number 7. And of course, using experience, I've already mentioned it, by especially trying to integrate learning and planning, that the question is, how do we fuse simulated and real experience? And if I'm working, for example, with a simple memory buffer for doing replay sequences, how do I style that memory? Do I have a simple ring buffer, for example, and how big is that memory? So how many state action transitions do I save in that memory? So as we can see here from that non-exhaustive list, there are many things to be considered when applying reinforcement learning to optimal decision problems. And I believe this is really the interesting challenge here for engineers working with reinforcement learning that we have so many degrees of freedom which have to be probably addressed when finding suitable reinforcement learning algorithms to a given problem. Yeah, so if we then summarize what we have did so far is we worked on small action and state spaces where the reinforcement learning process in terms of value, prediction, or also policy improvements could be saved and stored fully in simple memories in lookup tables. However, now, and this will be the second part of the course during the next couple of lectures, we will focus on reinforcement learning either with continuous variables where the state or action space can contain continuous variables and therefore the number of possible state action pairs becomes automatically infinite, or even if we have still a discrete problem space but the number of state and action pairs becomes unfeasible large. If you remember, for example, backgammon, the game of backgammon, there have been roughly 10 to the power of 20 different state action pairs, and I personally would not like to store that large amount of information on my hard disk, and therefore in these cases we have to apply function approximators in order to reduce the memory demand and therefore ensure that we can still apply our reinforcement learning techniques in a feasible computational way. And this will be then the focus, function approximators, especially in the next lecture. So how can we map our a large problem space with an approximative function, which for example is parametrizable with short parameter vectors. And then based on this, let's say, excursion into the field of function approximators as a tool of, for example, supervised learning, which will be the next lecture, we will then use these function approximators as tools in order to transfer the reinforcement learning solutions from the previous lectures to the domain of unfeasible large discrete state and action spaces, or also on the continuous state and action space cases. And with that summary of our first part, or first 60-70% of the course here of reinforcement learning at Paderborn University, I would like to thank you for your kind attention and wish you a pleasant week. See you soon. Bye-bye.